This is the Ethanol hydrometer. If it flows at exactly 100, that means we are getting 100% ethanol. Today, you will exactly learn how to make 100% ethanol using only cooking wine and a drying agent we made previously in another video. In this video, I'll go over the steps of concentrating ethanol to 95% from cooking wine, drying 95% ethanol to 100%, explaining the complete experiment setup, tips and tricks, and covering the cost breakdown. As always, there are timestamps for different chapters. Feel free to skip to the part you need. Ethanol is a very good solvent in chemistry, but there are a few common problems regarding its acquisition, and we will be tackling all this in today's video. The first issue is that commercial grade ethanol is usually just around 95%, which is insufficient for some applications. Secondly, most commercially available anhydrous ethanols are denatured alcohol, which has additives including methanol, isopropanol, etc. to prevent you from drinking it. These impurities won't affect most reactions, but when it does, they are very difficult to purify. Lastly, ethanol itself is rather expensive as a common lab reagent. Standard disclaimer, do not try this at home, and distilling alcohol in some countries may be illegal. More importantly, do not use open flame. Hey, welcome back to Dangerous Lab. I'm the untrained chemist. Okay, let's go over the material needed for this experiment. Firstly, of course you will need cooking wine. The star of the show, the one I'm using is salted cooking wine bought in the local supermarket. The highest I can get is around 17.5%. As for why it's salted, I will explain it in a bit. Secondly, you will need a drying agent to dry an ethanol from 95% to 100%. I've already made this in my last video. Go check it out if you haven't already. I will also include a few other options later in this video. Thirdly, you will need a fractional distillation setup, and this is not optional since a simple distillation setup won't work for distilling ethanol efficiently. Lastly, you will need a filtration setup for the drying part. A very simple one would do. Without further ado, let's assemble the fractional distillation setup. I'm using a 300mm regrow column, but it is not very efficient and is only a bare minimum required for this experiment. So if you have an even longer column or more efficient column, definitely use those. I will explain a little bit more regarding fractional distillation later in this video. A thermometer at the top of the distillation adapter is required for precisely monitoring the distillate temperature. Make sure the bottom of the thermometer is low enough to contact the vapor front fully, otherwise it won't be accurately measuring the distillate temperature. I'm using a 1-liter aluminum flask and a hot plate here, mostly just for clarity. But I usually use a 1-liter three-neck round bottom flask due to the ease of refilling ethanol. To begin the distillation, charge the flask with 600ml of salted cooking wine, which conveniently is the whole bottle. Add a stir bar and start heating it at 250 degrees Celsius, and turn on the water recirculator to get the condenser flowing. An important reminder here, as the required temperature varies greatly on different setups. So my temperature used it might not work for you. You need to closely monitor the vapor temperature to determine the required temperature for your setup. While we wait for the ethanol to heat up, let me explain why I choose cooking wine as a source of ethanol. First of all, alcoholic beverages in most countries are taxable, meaning that a portion of the price paid for buying alcoholic beverages is just going to be the tax. This sometimes also applies to reagent-grade ethanol as well, unless they're denatured, which usually contains undrinkable impurities, such as methanol or isopropanol, as a means for tax avoidance. Another way to avoid tax is to introduce a small percentage of salt into ethanol, which makes it taste bad for drinking. But this is perfectly doable in cooking wine, and this is why cooking wine is probably the cheapest source of ethanol. Also, cooking wine is commonly available in most countries. It is readily accessible in supermarkets. So it's the go-to source of ethanol for amateur chemists if you don't already have access to a purer source. Last but not least, cooking wine contains only salt as the impurities in contrast to denatured ethanol, which contains methanol or isopropanol. Pure ethanol can be separated from cooking wine relatively easily using distillation. ethanol and water will form a non-ideal mixture that deviates positively from Raoult's law. So ethanol from cooking wine will be enriched in ethanol for each subsequent distillation. Multiple cycles of distillation are required for 17.5% ethanol get to the azeotropic concentration of 95.6%. It will be extremely inefficient using only simple distillation. And this is where fractional distillation comes into play. A single column that allowing multiple boiling condensing cycles to happen internally. You can see the vapor front rising to a point in the real group column and start condensing back to liquid. The vapor that finally makes it through the whole column will be enriched with mostly ethanol. Depending on the temperature control, sometimes a single pass of fractional distillation is adequate for 17.5% ethanol to reach its azeotropic concentration. The efficiency of a fractionating column is often gauged by a metric called HETP, height equivalent to the theoretical plate. Theoretical plate means a single simple distillation equivalent. So for fractional distillation, you want just enough theoretical plates in your fractionating column to separate the components. Professional distillation will use a reflux splitter to control the reflux ratio of the distillation. But for us amateurs, we use different lengths or packing in the column, heat source temperature and ambient temperature to control the HETP. I won't go over too much about fractional distillation in this video. You can check out the supplementary links in the description if you would like to learn more. In general, you will need to monitor the temperature of the vapor in the distilling head for precise control. It's best to collect only when the vapor distills over at 78.2 degrees Celsius. If the temperature overshoots, then turn down the heat source. Or if the vapor struggles to reach the distilling head, increase the temperature of the heat source. It's important that the fractionating column cannot be adiabatic. You cannot insulate the column or otherwise it will work like a simple distillation. Even though many references said that you need to insulate the column, they're referring to the case where you have a reflux splitter, which I'm not using here. I guess most amateurs won't be using that as well. Distillation is so simple, yet so complicated. Ethanol forms an azeotrope with water, which cannot exceed 95.6% by distillation, which is the highest concentration we can get by fractional distillation. While it is already very useful as a solvent or for many reactions, some reactions require the water content to be very low. In other words, 100% ethanol is needed. To obtain 100% ethanol, drying is usually the preferred method to do so. In the following chapters, I will go over the drying method and the selection of drying agents. There are many ways to dry ethanol. Some are more advanced than others, and usually require additional setup, so I will not go over it here. Those include azeotropic distillation, chemical drying, and reverse osmosis. We'll be using the simplest method, drying by desiccant. This is where our previously made anhydrous magnesium sulfate comes into play. While it is one of the most accessible drying agents, it's not the best overall. Anhydrous sodium sulfate and 3A molecular sieve can also be used. I've included a simplified pros and cons list on the screen. For most people, anhydrous magnesium sulfate will work just fine, so I will be using it for a demonstration. The steps should be relatively similar if another drying agent is used. In theory, anhydrous magnesium sulfate can take up to 7 moles of water for every mole of salt, but full hydration takes some time, so I will assume it has only 50% efficiency in this case. As such, we will be using around 7.8 grams of anhydrous magnesium sulfate to dry every 100 ml of 95% ethanol. 14 grams of anhydrous magnesium sulfate is added to the aluminum flask containing 180 ml of 95% ethanol. The flask is then stopped and allowed to sit overnight, ideally for 24 hours with occasional swirling to let the salt fully absorb the water in the ethanol. Decant the solution and filter it through filtered glass or filter paper, then collect the filtrate in an aluminum flask for another distillation. And I actually did a second drying with another 4 grams of anhydrous magnesium sulfate off camera, as I didn't swirl regularly on the first drying, resulting in only 98% ethanol. Since magnesium sulfate is slightly soluble in ethanol, it's not recommended to use the 100% ethanol right after filtration. Perform another simple distillation to remove any remaining particles, or dissolve the magnesium sulfate to obtain the extra pure 100% ethanol. I would recommend doing the same procedure if you are using other drying agents, even for 3A molecular sieve, as it will occasionally leave fine dust in the ethanol even after filtration. According to the hydrometer reading, yes, we arrived at 100% ethanol. In this two-part experiment, we used two bottles of 600ml cooking wine and obtained 180ml of 95% ethanol, resulting in an 81% recovery rate. It recovered 118ml of 100% ethanol after drying with anhydrous magnesium sulfate, resulting in a 69% recovery rate, which is a 56% yield for the overall reaction. Anhydrous magnesium sulfate is particularly weak in terms of recovery rate, as a relatively large amount of solid is needed, and solvent will still stick to the solid, creating a massive mechanical loss. To store the dried 100% ethanol, you can store it over small amounts of 3A molecular sieve to prolong its shelf life, or store it as is. You will need to decant it carefully or use a pipette to draw liquid out if you choose to store it over molecular sieve. Okay, now for the big question. Is this method of getting 100% ethanol cheaper than just buying it? Two bottles of 600ml cooking wine cost about $3. Drying agents, 10 cents. Electricity, 30 cents. So the total cost is $3.3 per 118ml, which translates to $28 per liter. Considering the cost and difficulty of getting anhydrous ethanol, this method is a win. There's also one extra thing to mention. Although the hydrometer measurement shows 100% ethanol, there's still a tiny bit of water in it. It can be used in most reactions that require an anhydrous solvent to begin with, except those water-sensitive reactions, including the Grignard reaction. Water-sensitive reactions require in-situ chemical drying, which is out of scope in this video. Oh, also, I recently started a Discord server. Join it through the link in the description and come hang out with us. This is the second part of the video series. I've already planned 5 videos in total, but I'm not revealing them yet. Try to leave your guesses in the comments down below. If you haven't watched it, the previous one already, click the video on the screen to watch it now. Or maybe the next one is already out by the time you watch this. Anyway, drop a like if you made it to the end or subscribe if you haven't already. Remember to stay curious, and I will see you in the next one.